Last time I emphasized how difficult it is to represent a faithful discussion of what Boltzmann did, in particular because of the enormous amount of papers he left behind and the fact that he never condensed any of that into a systematic account of what approach he favored. And another, I may sound very critical of Boltzmann at times. It's not out of a wish to, you know, say that he was a bad scientist or something. I have great admiration for Boltzmann. But it's probably fair to say that he approached his subject very often with a strong intuitive mind and didn't always present his arguments in the clearest and rigorous formulations that we are now often used at in science, in physical science. The reason why I'm sometimes critical of Boltzmann is only in order to give some counter voice to a predominant idea that Boltzmann had all the answers and that he knew it all and that he solved all of these problems in the 19th century. When I come to Gibbs, I fortunately can take a quite different attitude. What Gibbs left behind is only one book, about 250 pages, and that contains everything he had to say about statistical mechanics, except for a very short abstract of a lecture he had given about 10 years earlier.
Well, there's also that long paper on the equilibrium of heterogeneous
stuff. Yes, but that's thermodynamics.
Okay.
Yeah. So Gibbs, in a sense, has, at least in statistical physics, has two instantiations. There are four papers by him around 1870s on thermodynamics, and I talked a little bit about what he did there. Those are long page papers. One paper is more than 300 pages. One publisher came along and said, "Will you ever expand that into a book?" And he said, "No, I think I have already exhausted the patience of my readers by making it too long." But anyway, what he presented on, and so for many of the European physicists at that time, and there was sort of battle going on between, should we adhere to this empirical principle theory of thermodynamics and stay away from any speculations of molecular constitution, or should we side with Boltzmann and say, yes, matter consists of atoms and that should be an important part of important assumption in how we proceed. Most people thought that that Gibbs would side with the former. And there were many people who were surprised to see that in 1902, and he died shortly afterwards, he had actually been working on the project which is closely associated with Boltzmann at the time. And he coined the phrase statistical mechanics. This is the first time the term actually appears in the literature. Boltzmann, as I said, never clearly delineated between what we call kinetic theory and statistical mechanics, and he typically used simply the word gas theory for what he was. Now, what Gibbs is trying to do, and he says very clearly in the opening pages of his book, is that he is merely trying to give a clear, transparent, and rigorous account of the most elementary principles that would be needed in a statistical approach of mechanics, and that by no means is it his goal to elucidate any of the mysteries of nature. His emphasis, his goal, is rather on the logic of the arguments. He wants to clear that up and to see how far we can get by making only the most general assumptions needed. But he's not very interested in developing or justifying particular models of the type of mechanical systems we might be studying. So indeed, the very assumption that matter is constituted of molecules doesn't appear in the book until the very last chapter. All the rest is completely general, and the only remnant of that assumption of molecular constitution that is needed in his work is only that the phase space is going to have a finite dimension. Okay, perhaps it's might be useful to come back in this context to this distinction that Einstein once made between principal theories and constructive theories, where it is rather clear that kinetic theory of gases falls under the constructive side, because it operates with hypotheses about how matter is constituted, while thermodynamics, trying to remain aloof of that, is on the principle side. We also raised questions about whether that dichotomy is actually a general one, or whether it's a worthwhile dichotomy to pursue in other theories of physics. Well, here is already a somewhat problematic case. I mean, is statistical mechanics, in the spirit that Gibbs presents it, a principal theory or a constructive theory? Well, of course, it goes a little bit into the assumption about how matter is constituted, namely in the sense that we can give a mechanical picture of it, that there is a phase space, that there is a Hamiltonian. But other than that, whether it's composed of molecules, whether these molecules are hard spheres, or how they interact with each other, or many other assumptions, all of that is not even touched by Gibbs. So once again, he tries to only formulate a set of principles. They might not be completely empirical, but they're still very general. And he stays away from the practice of model building that would be typical for the kinetic theory of gases. So, in an important sense, I think that Gibbs' statistical mechanics is still a principal theory, although it's of course closely related to the kinetic gas theory of Boltzmann, and it's meant perhaps to give a logical cleanup of what Boltzmann had been doing. And in a sense, I think that type of lesson will also generalize further. I don't think actually that there are principal theories and constructive theories in physics. I think that there are scientists who take a constructive approach, or a more principled approach to a particular theory. But you could take these two different approaches, or different people could take two different approaches for the same subject area. So it's not a useful enterprise to try and divide all the theories in physics between those two categories. At least that's what I think. So anyway, what does Gibbs assume? As I said, we assume phase space. And it's a finite dimension. And we assume that there is a Hamiltonian. So points in your space space, I will denote by letter x. And the Hamiltonian is some function from gamma to the real numbers. Hx is energy. In point x. Usually that Hamiltonian will give rise to Hamiltonian equations of motion. We could write those down, but actually what we only presuppose to be true is that there is a time evolution . Let's call that T of T, and that is supposed to be a one parameter group, continuous one parameter group. And that mapping will send any point in phase space into the point that it occupies later due to the evolution generated by the Hamiltonian. So, and again, in the picture, this is gamma. Any point x, there will be a trajectory passing through each point, which will give you evolution of the state as it evolves, and these trajectories have the properties that they will never intersect each other, and of course that they fill the whole phase space, and there's no beginning or no end. Although they might sometimes turn back into themselves and form a periodic motion. Okay, all of that is pretty standard. And then the statistical part of theory, as I mentioned before, is that we assume a probability density rho of x over gamma. And as I said before, you could think of that probability density, at least in a sort of mental image, as representing an ensemble. So there's a whole, in fact, an infinite amount of other systems which we imagine. They are sort of closely related to X. And that is going to be rho And these replicas of the system we're actually considering evolve along, according to their trajectories, into this probability. The picture, if you like, and if you certainly if you want to be a frequentist about all of this, is something like this. So maybe the system is a cylinder of gas at a certain pressure. Now, of course, we have only one system here in our laboratory. We're interested in its thermal properties and how we could get that from its microscopic state. But now, imagine that, as a matter of fact, we got that cylinder of gas from a factory that produces endless series of cylinders in similar states. So, for example, the factory specifies there is so much nitrogen in this cylinder and it's delivered at this macroscopic pressure, and there's a whole, in principle, endless series of cylinders that's being produced coming out on the conveyor belt, and we pick at random just one of those cylinders, and that's all we know about the cylinder we're dealing with. Every gas in this sequence of cylinders will have its particles situated at different positions. They might be moving at different velocities, and so on, and so on. The only thing they have in common is that in all of these cases, they will have the specified amount of pressure, and so on. So these copies could be just the alternative cylinders chosen. And all we know is that the gas you're dealing with is one of those. And we can only assign probabilities to its properties by averaging over the other members of the ensemble. That is roughly how you should picture an ensemble. But there's, of course, one important point. In no way should different members of the ensemble be allowed to interact with each other. That is out of the picture. Of course, if I literally maintain that all the other members of the ensembles are just figments of our imagination, then I would have good reason for not to show that, because figments do not interact with the real world. Okay, so far so good, and perhaps it's useful, just for the sake of the argument, to say how much of the usual pictures we have left out, and also why that might be a good thing. So, for example, if the system is a gas, then our usual assumption would be that the state is specifiable by giving n positions and n particle n momenta. For all the particles, and that the Hamiltonian would take the special form in which there's a kinetic energy term plus some, let me use letter 5 in this case, potential term. Plus, perhaps, or especially if we want to convey, contain the entire system in a volume, let's say, something which depends on, let's say, let's take a product. Where this is the so-called wall potential would be something like something which is flat or even zero inside of the container and then jumps to infinity at the walls of the container. So that this potential term will keep the particles contained in the finite. There are, of course, a number of peculiarities or striking points about this type of Hamiltonians, which Gibbs abstracts from. In the first place, there is apparently a distinction between positions and momenta. They might not literally be positions and momenta. The Hamiltonian formulation uses generally generalized positions and generalized momenta. But in classical particle mechanics, there always are positions and momenta. That's part of the structure of phase space. It's part of the structure that is not used in Gibbs's approach. To use a fancy word, it's the idea that a Hamiltonian phase space has a symplectic structure. One of the points about that is precisely because of this division of coordinates in two groups, is that Hamiltonian phase spaces in the symplectic case will always have an even dimension, because the number of independent coordinates must be a multiple of two. The other thing, of course, is that the Hamiltonian here splits very nicely into two parts, one of which only depends on the momenta, the other part only depends on the positions, and that the part that depends on the momenta has this nice form in which it's just a sum over squares of the momentum. That's, of course, standard assumptions we might need to deal with particles in a gas. But nothing that Gibbs is going to say will depend on that. And this is not just some point about being parsimonious in your logical assumptions. And although this is not anything that Gibbs ever raises, but look at, for example, some other types of systems that we might want to do statistical physics upon. And it very soon, in 10 years' time or so, people have been studying, for example, magnetic systems and their thermal behavior, also since the late 19th century, with Langevin and Curie and others. And it turned out very soon that Hamiltonian methods, and particularly Gibbs' methods, are perfectly suited to deal with them. Now, what do we use in that case? Even if we don't want to use quantum mechanics, we can think of a system which is a magnetic dipole. So it's some particular vector of given length. And the configuration of our system would simply be the orientation of that vector in space. And we can write down a Hamiltonian in this case, which would be, if there's an external magnetic field, would be given just by the inner product of that dipole with the magnetic field. There might be many of such dipoles in our system, and we might want some of them. And perhaps to make things more interesting, we might add some term in which they interact. Now, that is a perfectly reasonable Hamiltonian. It's defined on the phase space. We can apply statistical mechanics to it just fine. But look at the differences. Can anybody tell what the kinetic and what the position and the momentum coordinates are? Is there a division between the kinetic term and the potential term? No, there isn't. In fact, there are striking differences, of course, even for a single particle. The phase space is the surface of the sphere that describes all the configurations of the orientation of this single factor. That's a two-dimensional surface, all right. But unlike the case for a single particle, it is not a Cartesian product. And so, for example, if we would take that surface, so this is just a unit sphere, and this is the dipole factor. We can, of course, choose some system of coordinates, which would make the space two-dimensional. And if you like, you could call one of them position and the other one momentum. That would work perfectly well, although it might be a little bit arbitrary. But it would only work locally in a region. There's no way to extend these coordinate systems globally over the entire phase space in the way that it can be done for a Cartesian product. The other typical thing about such systems is that where here the energy has typically a lower bound, at least if this one is potential function as well. But it doesn't have an upper bound. Any amount of energy that your system might have, you can always put more energy into the system by making the particles go faster. And even if we assume that there is a maximum to the velocity, of light, there's no maximum to the momentum. And so Hamiltonians don't have, in this case, don't have an upper bound. In this case, they do. There's not only a ground state for the energy, there's also a ceiling state, which the energy cannot exceed. And that's why, for example, in this case, the subject has been raised slightly before, we can get surprising things like absolute temperatures becoming negative, which you could never have in this case. What I just want to stress for the moment is that by assuming not much more than what Gibbs was doing, he actually opened us up to theory for a wealth of other systems other than merely particles contained in some given volume, and they would all be treatable by the methods. And the results that he's going to present can immediately be extended to those two. In fact, when classical theory was replaced by quantum theory, and people did away even with the notion of a phase space, there was still a Hamiltonian, which was now represented by a self-adjoint operator, etc. But much of what Gibbs said fits seamlessly to the new microdynamics given by quantum theory, with only the most minimal changes needed. So, staying aloof from too many assumptions was certainly a important advantage to the way Gibbs presented his work. Okay, so far so good. We are going to pretend that the system we're interested in is just one member of an ensemble of similar systems, and that the probability that its state is anywhere in state space is given by this probability density. And what we will be interested in is how this probability distribution evolves in the course of time. And that evolution, of course, is simply borrowed from the evolution we have already defined on states themselves. So if this point evolves into there, and this point evolves somewhere else here, then we will have the evolution, the distribution function, the probability density at a later time just by following evolutions of the states. And so, in fact, we can simply mimic, there's a minus sign here, because what it says is that the distribution at time t is just the distribution at the time, where the points were, is just the value of the distribution where the point x was time t ago, right? And if you want to have the same thing in differential form, you can also have it. I think it's this, maybe with a minus sign, I don't remember these things too well, where these are the so-called Fresnel brackets, if you are familiar with them. Yes?
Is that T subscript minus T?
Minus T.
Oh, sorry, good, okay.
Now, so far we haven't done anything, and certainly we haven't talked about thermal properties at all. So, if we want to obtain anything like the structure of thermodynamics from this framework, we'd better make some additional identifications or proposals for connecting up concepts from the different theories. And so the first thing is to identify conditions which are associated with equilibrium. Now, in thermodynamics, of course, the crucial point about equilibrium is that nothing seems to change in the course of time anymore. And we would expect here that a particular ensemble would represent such a situation. If it is the case that all the averages over the ensemble do not change in time anymore. And that condition, which Gibbs calls statistical equilibrium, is simply the condition that rho of t, in fact, is stationary. That is to say that it doesn't depend on time anymore.
Talking about statistical equilibrium, referring to all the ensemble, but all the ensemble is considering many systems, and maybe your system of interest is, you know, means maybe too strong.
Too strong.
I don't see why all the systems have to be stationary.
Let me try to elucidate. I was going to say that anyway. This does not mean that any of the systems in the ensemble doesn't evolve in time, doesn't continue changing its properties in time. What it just means is that whenever there's a region in phase space that my system occupies at a certain time and which it leaves a second later, there is another member of the ensemble who will travel into that region and take the first one's place, so that all my expectations, all the averages that I calculate over the ensemble, will turn out to be stationary, the same value for all times. But every member of the ensemble might still be showing a very definite evolution in the course of time. So I'm not claiming that all the systems are stationary. Not at all. In fact, I'm not claiming stationarity for any of them. Is this clear? So, take another simple example. Suppose I was dealing with the harmonic oscillator. So this is its phase space, and this is one of its energy hypersurfaces. It's an ellipse, and the trajectory from one particular point would be just traveling around the ellipse. Now, here's an ensemble. I just take roughly evenly spaced states all over energy hypersurface. And you can consider all of them moving, and since the Hamiltonian also dictates the speed at which they move, they all move same speed over this circle. So I would have a stationary distribution, although each and every individual states, each and every individual systems in the ensemble, is executing a perfectly periodic motion. None of them are stationary, yet the distribution over the states doesn't change. Does that clarify the situation? Of course, this is also precisely one of the problems or drawbacks of this proposal. So this is supposed to correspond. Let's say thermodynamical equilibrium. This is one of the puzzles about the entire Gibbsian approach. We only have this particular gas in our laboratory, and we are interested in its supposedly thermal properties. Now, in this approach, we are going to describe the system by means of the ensemble, which means we add all these other imaginary phase points to our consideration. And whether we will have statistical equilibrium or not is going to be answered only by considering the ensemble. Statistical equilibrium is a property of the probability distribution and therefore of the ensemble. But since one and the same system could be drawn from different ensembles, there's no way in which we can look at that single system and its behavior and determine whether it's in statistical equilibrium. We can only answer that question if we have the entire ensemble at our disposal. So the question, here I have a particular system, is it in equilibrium or not, in Gibbs's approach, is unanswerable. And it might be that the system we're looking at is in violent evolution and still could be represented by statistical equilibrium.
On the other hand, he says, I only care about recovering something like thermodynamics in systems composed of very many degrees of freedom. And he argues that the macroscopic properties in these stationary ensembles are going to have very small variance. And so you could argue that for systems of many degrees of freedom, the macroscopic properties aren't going to change much.
That's certainly a part of the strategy. but as far as I remember, I said that the idea that the system is composed of particles, and that we are actually interested in taking the case where the number of particles becomes very, very large. That only occurs towards the end of the book,
right?
And what I'm doing here is I'm pointing out a problem, and I'm perfectly aware that there are certain limiting situations in which the problem might become less urgent and, in fact, even surely disappear. That's difficult, of course, for many of the points I'm going to make. Okay. So, if we want to have candidates for a description of thermodynamical equilibrium, we better be looking at stationary distributions. And then the question arises, which distributions are stationary? Well, there might be many of those, and it will depend decisively on the nature of the Hamiltonian, of how many there are. We do know that, let me first put it this way, so rho t x is stationary, and I think I can say only if it depends on conserved quantities. And we do know that there is at least, in general, one conserved quantity of the system, which is the Hamiltonian.
Isn't that if and only if?
Sorry?
Isn't that if and only if?
Yeah, that's what I think. So here's I hope this notation makes sense to you. If the distribution depends on X only through the Hamiltonian, that is to say, this distribution function assigns equal values to all points in phase space for which the Hamiltonian has equal values, that is to say, it is constant on energy hypersurfaces, then we will be guaranteed that it is going to be stationary. These are all stationary. Therefore, they are a class of candidates for. Are they the only ones? Well, that depends on the question of whether there are additional conserved quantities. Whether that will be the case depends very much on the Hamiltonian. And if anything like the ergodic hypothesis is true, well, actually, or something slightly weaker, this is going to be equivalent to the assumption that there are no additional conserved quantities. And so, that in those circumstances, this class of conserved quantities, this class of stationary distributions is the only class of stationary distributions. Good. Then we have singled out a more definite set of stationary distributions. And now Gibbs chooses simply as the most straightforward examples. Picks out for consideration two definite choices, one being the so-called micro-canonic distribution, which is in slightly more modern notation using the Dirac delta function. A distribution which is zero outside of a given energy hypersurface, but constant modulo gradient of the Hamiltonian on that surface. And of course, then we have to normalize that thing by dividing by the structure function, which is simply the area of the energy hypersurface. And the other is the canonical distribution, which by fiat is simply something, again using a slightly more modern notation than Gibbs himself is using, an exponent of the Hamiltonian multiplied by some parameter, and again that's normalization dependent on. These are just two particular choices that happen to be members of the general set of distributions that just happen to depend only on the Hamiltonian and are therefore guaranteed to be stationary and therefore good candidates for the description of statistical equilibrium. Now, can we do more to see whether we do have something like an analogy to the properties we are familiar with in thermodynamics? And by the way, I should perhaps stress this also. Gibbs' approach, I mean, I mentioned in the beginning, his emphasis seems to be on logical clarity and rigor of the derivations. And he is typically very careful and cautious when it comes to making claims. Again, in contrast to Boltzmann, who sometimes claimed more than he actually obtained. So Gibbs says that he is interested in the foundations of thermodynamics, but he never says that he has actually reduced thermodynamics to statistical mechanics. The most he ever claims of having made is to provide an analogy to thermodynamics. And so statistical equilibrium for him is something which you could regard as analogous to thermodynamics, and whether these particular choices will extend the analogy is something to be investigated. But an analogy, of course, is not the same thing as a full reduction in the sense of theory reduction. So, the first thing he does is simply to consider two systems. X and Y. And each of them has their own state space, which might be very different. This might be a gas, this might be a set of magnets, this might form. They might have very different numbers of particles. We don't care. And the only thing we want to assume is that we can put them into something which might be analogous to thermal contact, which is to say, we put them together and we suppose that they might have some interaction between them so that they can exchange energy. So, the combined system let's call it X and Y, we'll have state space which is now a Cartesian product. Of the original ones, and we assume that the Hamiltonian of that combined system is something like the Hamiltonian of the first system plus the Hamiltonian of the second system plus some interaction which will depend on both states from both phase spaces. And we also assume that that interaction is, at least in some norm sense, much smaller than the norm of the other two. So to give you this more physical example, there might just be a grain of dust somewhere which will then can collide with members of first with particles in the first system and transmit that momentum to particles of the second system. But it's not necessarily something that brain does that actually can carry a lot of energy. It's just sufficient to bring about some interaction between the two. But it's not going to change the values of the overall Hamiltonian very much. Now, further suppose that for each of those two systems, I had a canonical distribution. So the point that Gibbs is going to make is to say that this is a canonical distribution for the combined system, and under the assumptions I just made, this is going to be different functions. And you see, of course, that if that interaction term is only negligible with respect to the other two, I can sort of neglect it in the exponential. And then the whole thing will factorize into what will be partition function for the first system times the similar distribution for the second system. And so conversely, if I would have had first system in a canonical distribution with a given value of beta, and the second system also in a canonical distribution for the same value of beta, even though the rest of the Hamiltonian had a very different form, and I bring them together, then by this chain of reason, then their total distribution would be this form, and it would automatically, since of this chain of almost equalities, we also be a canonical distribution for the combined system. In other words, beta will have the properties of temperature in the sense that if I have two systems in the same temperature, I put them together in thermal contact, then the combined system will still be in an equilibrium state. And in fact, it will have the same temperature as those two.
With thermal coupling, thermal contact means coupling them weakly.
Yes.
Yes,
that's
small.
Yes, exactly. If they were each in equilibrium states for different values of beta, then the conclusion would not hold. So it's only when they have the same value of beta that upon thermal contact they will remain in thermal, the whole system will remain in equilibrium. Yes?
Can I ask a bit more about the approximation of H, the H1 plus H2 when you ignore the interaction term? Just looking at it naively, it seems to me that even if the interaction term is much smaller than H1 or H2, because it comes in the exponential, it's still a affect the ratio between, say,
can
affect the ratio between, say, rho x1 y1 and rho x2 y2 quite considerably. If you include that term, even though it's smaller than h1 and h2, because it appears in the exponential, it might still have a substantial effect.
It appears in the exponential, but in a sum with the other two, which are much larger.
Sure, so you think about the factor at the front of e to the minus b, h interaction.
Right? Yeah.
But couldn't that factor at the front have quite a substantial effect on the value of rho x, y, even though h interaction is much smaller than h1, h2?
It could affect, what could it affect, do you think?
The value of rho x, y. Because making a small change to the exponent can make have a large effect on the overall value.
I think
does it work near equilibrium or not far away from it or something like that?
The argument is, it might be a small thing, and still, because it's in the exponent, it might have the exponent might blow up small values. But the point of the argument is that it's relative to. So it's not whether H interaction might be very large, which would be all right if these things were larger still.
But the only
thing that's being assumed is that it's small relative to the others.
But 2 to the power of 1,001 is quite a bit bigger than 2 to the power of 1,000, even though it's much more than 1,000.
Yeah. Well, if there are overall factors on the values, they are simply going to be absorbed in the normalization constants.
Well, that's why I talked about the ratio between the two rows,
actually, just make it small enough so that it doesn't make enough difference.
Exactly. Do the calculation.
You can make two.
Yeah.
You make 2 to the 1,000th plus x as close as you want to do 2 to the 1,000th by making. So, read that small. That's much smaller than as small enough so that this is an approximately stationary.
Yeah, it could be small enough. Yeah.
See that. Right.
I take it. Gibbs just needs any non-zero value, no matter how small, for the coupling to happen. It's an equilibrium system, so he's patient, he'll wait for equilibrium to become established. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that's fine.
There's actually a similar argument in Einstein's, when he, for himself, tried to rediscover, without knowing Gibbs's work, tried to work out the same things. And of course, having established it, you will also immediately have the counterpart of the zero law of thermodynamics, namely that thermal equilibrium is going to be transitive, because in this case, it's precisely thermal equilibrium, the relation between canonical ensembles, is represented by the betas in both cases being equal. Now, equality between parameters is a transitive relation. Therefore, thermal equilibrium is a transitive equation. So, we have some intuitive grounds for associating beta with temperature. It reproduces some of the conceptual structure we had associated with temperature. Now, that's not all. Gibbs wants to do something slightly more, and that, of course, is can we reproduce what he had been calling the fundamental equation of thermodynamics. Now, there are a couple of things that are obvious if you want to have something analogous to that. The first thing is that the energy, of course, is going to correspond to the average, the expectation values of the Hamiltonian. This is going to be true both for the micro-canonical and for the canonical distribution. And it's a perfectly natural idea. Each of those points has a value for its Hamiltonian. Might be slightly different from different systems. We don't know exactly what our system, which member of the ensemble it's going to be. So to find the representative, the statistical representative of the thermodynamical energy, we simply choose the expectation value or average over the ensemble of all the OX individual, slightly different.
But I think there's also a large N approximation going here because, you know, for large N, there's going to be a small dispersion in energy. So with high probability, every element of that ensemble is going to have the same energy, which is equal to, which is close. It's going to have energy close to the expectation value. So I can sort of divide the difference between the actual energy of the system and the expectation value because there's not very much dispersion.
Again, I'm totally sympathetic to what you're saying. I don't think, I might be mistaken if I have to reread Gibbs to see that, but I don't think that he presupposes the number of constituents being large in order to make this analogy. But I certainly agree very much with you that if N is large, it would only help us make that association, because that is not only the expectation value, is not only the expectation value, but if the dispersion is so small, that it's also the overwhelmingly most likely.
Because I actually think he prefaces the chapter titled Thermodynamic Analogies, and I think he prefaces that with a discussion that says, what we want to do is recover thermodynamics as limiting behavior as the number of constituents increases, and you know, shortly thereafter he mentions that dispersion in H is going to go as 1 over root N. The relative dispersion,
Of course, I completely. I have nothing to object to what you're saying. So I agree, but even so, if we just wanted to concentrate on the formal relationship, that point is not essential to what he's doing. Volume is the parameter in Hamiltonian. Like I mentioned just a minute ago, at least for particles, we assume that there is some wall potential which is zero inside the container, but jumps very largely at the edges, and so the size of the volume of the container is going to be a parameter in one term. So
again, it's a little more general than that. He basically assumes that there's some parameters in Hamiltonian.
He's more general than that.
Which are such that by manipulating them, we do work on the system.
Yeah. Now, what else have you got to do? You've got pressure. And I said is, but I should merely say corresponds to. Now, pressure will correspond exactly to how the energy changes if we perform small changes of the volume. That's exactly, of course, the amount of work that's being done. If we compress the container, the piston of a container a little bit, and then again take an average over the ensemble, and then there should be a minus sign. So now we've done our bit, and there are just two things remaining, and for this is going to be different for the canonical and for the micro-canonical. So in the canonical case, the idea is that temperature is associated with beta. Well, actually, it's the inverse temperature, so beta is going to be 1 over k.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, over beta?
Yep.
No, 1 over k. Where k is Boltzmann's constant. And we have to find something which would be representative of entropy, and Gibbs comes up with the idea that this would be representative by a quantity which I will call sigma, and which is a functional on rho, and it's it's just the integral of rho log rho over the entire set space.
With a k.
Now, if you make that correspondence, then you can show that indeed you will get the relation, k beta d sigma plus h d v. So you say, hey, look, I've got a relation for my family of canonical ensembles which mimics precisely what we would expect for a thermal system, and I can identify certain quantities in my theory, identify is too strong, draw an analogy between certain quantities in my theory with the appropriate thermodynamical quantities. Isn't that nice? Isn't that precisely the structure that we need, and as I tried to stress before, is actually sufficient to describe all the thermal properties for a thermodynamical system. Yes, it is. There are just a couple of problems that seem to make the association slightly more troublesome than it would appear perhaps on first instance. Let me point out that there is a striking difference between say the representation of pressure and energy on the one hand and temperature and entropy on the other hand. Volume, of course, is also a different type because it's merely a parameter in the Hamiltonian. It's not a statistical average over anything. Is that surprising? Well, certainly not, I would say. Nobody, even in thermodynamics, would think that the volume is actually something you obtain from a statistical average over the micro constituents. It's simply a constraint obtained from the volume in which our system is enclosed. In statistical mechanics, it's no different. It's not an average over anything. It's just a parameter. Good. Pressure and energy in this approach are averages of functions defined on phase space. That is to say, for every point in phase space, I can specify what the value of the Hamiltonian is, and therefore what energy the system would have if it were to be found in that particular state. Similarly, since the derivative of the Hamiltonian is defined for every point, assuming the Hamiltonian is differentiable, I could say for any point in phase space, what pressure would be associated with that particular state. And now, what my statistical description is giving me is merely take an average over the ensemble of some property that each member of the ensemble would have by itself, and take that as our description of the thermal state. Right? So, to use a metaphor from quantum mechanics, it is as if a hidden variable interpretation is possible. We only specify an average, but it's very well open. In fact, the whole description invites the idea that each individual system in the ensemble actually has a particular value of energy and pressure, because these are averages over some function state space. The striking thing is that nor temperature nor entropy have that form. Temperature is just a parameter in the ensemble. It's not an average of some function on state space. So once again, what that means is I could give you some point in phase space and say, look, this is actually the microscopic state of some thermal system. I have told you now all the positions and all the velocities of all the particles in that state. Can you please tell me what the temperature of that system is? In this particular approach, the answer would be no. I cannot tell you from the microscopic state. I would first have to know from which canonical ensemble it would be a member, and then once I know what canonical ensemble I have, I would choose. Then I can read off the value of beta of that ensemble, and that would be my answer to the question, what is its temperature? But that doesn't depend on the particular state that we considered. It depends on the ensemble. As I said, one in the same state could be members of different ensembles. And one of the same ensemble could represent many, many different states. There is no one-to-one relation between states and ensembles. So, temperature is going to be a much more abstract notion than pressure and volume, in the sense that we do not have this type of hidden variable interpretation as if the system really has some particular temperature-like property and we're merely averaging over an ensemble. Should that be particularly worrisome? I don't know. There are, of course, cases to be made even in thermodynamics that, especially if you're an operationalist, that temperature is usually only defined by putting the system in contact with a heat bath, and that whatever temperature we assign to that system is actually just a property of the heat bath, not so much of the system. If you were to take that approach, then this might not be so worrisome to you. The temperature is not necessarily a property of the system. I think the case is even worse for entropy, because although this is just beta is just a parameter in the distribution, at least what we could do in principle is to try and find other functions on state space which could act as estimators of beta. So, for example, in many cases, or at least in some cases, for temperature, we can, at least sometimes, find functions on gamma such that at least for the canonical distributions, and I will use label averaging depending on the parameter beta as averaging over the canonical ensemble characterized by parameter beta, we could find functions, say A, such that this is equal to beta for all beta.
Let's change the logarithm of phase space volume of energy.
Sorry?
Let's change the log phase hypersurface volume of energy.
Yes. Well, I'm it would go too quick for me to say yes or no, but there are ways to get out of it. What I personally thought of is, at least in the case of when the Hamiltonian has at least some quadratic terms in it, like the momenta, you can show by the equipartition theorem that the average energy in one of those particular degrees of freedom will, in a canonical ensemble, be just one half, or at least would be related to temperature.
If it's very small, you can do it again.
Yes. But for this particular expression, that is impossible. I mean, this is a functional on the distribution. So once again, sigma is characteristic of the ensemble, not of this individual system. And of course, it partly already takes the form of an average over phase space. But it's an average for a different function for depending, it's a different function depending on the ensemble itself. It's not just one fixed quantity on phase space which we average over with rho. No, the quantity we average over varies with the distribution that we use to average over.
Yeah. Okay, it's not obvious to me that sigma is really in a much different boat than beta is. So beta is a parameter of the canonical distribution. And then you know, the sigma is an average of log rho, and rho is 1 over z e to the minus beta h. So the log rho is minus log z minus beta h. So it's log z, which is a param function of beta, minus beta times the expectation value of h. You know what I'm saying? It seems like it's, maybe if I could find an analog for beta.
If you want to get it directly, then why just think,
rho is 1 over z of beta e to the minus beta h, so log rho is minus z of beta minus beta h, so the expectation value of that is that. So if I can find, you know, an analog of, you know, for beta, then I assume that I just plug that into that and then subtract. And then there's an expectation value of something that is a phase function. So it seems like, to me, like they're in more or less the same boat. Now, what were you going to say, David?
Well, I was going to say, fairly directly, you know, beta is a Lagrange multiplier. Beta tells you the rate of change of, by construction, beta is the rate of change of Gibbs entropy with expected energy. So if I know beta, I can recover Gibbs entropy, vice versa, up to plus.
Yeah. Now if I were to extend the identification of, so this sigma is a functional of rho, which, you know, is well defined for any distribution function. So if I try to extend that identification beyond the canonical ensemble, which Gibbs didn't do but everyone else does, then, you know, you'd be more in more trouble.
That you tend to be more trouble. Yes. You're right. Yeah. If you only assume this particular form for the canonical distribution, there are ways out of the problem.
I mean, it's just worth mentioning that sigma, you know, everyone just calls it the Gibbs entropy and feels free to plug in all kinds of probability distributions other than the canonical.
Yes.
But we call the Hamiltonian, as far as I understand, Hamilton was not its originator. This is physics.
Okay, so anyway, we've got a formal analogy out of our framework so far, but it's not always simple or obvious to associate quantities that appear in this analogy with properties of the system that we are discussing. And that is certainly a very peculiar aspect of Gibbs. So I'm not quite sure whether that was a reason he considered, but it is certainly one of the aspects for not going out triumphantly claiming that we have fully reduced thermodynamics to the microscopic properties of our system in statistical mechanics. Things are slightly weirder in the case of the micro-canonical ensemble. In that case, Gibbs uses the same analogies for the things at pressure and volume, but in the case of entropy and temperature, he has two proposals. So one of them is temperature is going to in the micro-canonical case,
could you just stand so I can see it?
Yeah.
I don't know what they just said a moment ago. Is that for tea?
quantities. So this is one of the proposals that Gibbs mentions. But then again, he also says that we could also take another pair in which we replace the structure function by what is called the integrated structure function.
I think that my marker's dying.
So we would recover that same fundamental equation for more than one set of quantities. So this seems to be a underdetermination of what statistical mechanical quantities should correspond to the thermodynamical quantities. Now, once again, if the system consists of particles and the number of particles goes to the infinity, then at least in most of, at least in simple cases, I'm not sure how general it actually is, but at least in for ideal gases and for itself, for example, the difference between this set and that set is going to disappear very rapidly. And so if you're only interested in the limit in which n goes to infinity, you might not worry about the choice between those two. But of course one can argue that realistic systems are always finite, and if they're finite, there are differences between the two, and perhaps with the advent of more and more technology, we might be interested in smaller and smaller systems, and not necessarily in thermodynamical limits. And could we still use thermodynamical quantities to describe those small systems? And what choice should we make in those cases? And then, of course, all these worries reappear.
So you've highlighted that there's a difference. I'm interested in finding out just how extreme is it when we consider the kinds of systems that we're typically interested in, with the, so systems with, you know, large n in the order of 10 to the 26.
I don't really know, but there is a lively interest in those kinds of questions nowadays, especially with the advent of nanotechnology.
David has a question. You want a very crude rule of thumb that tends to get the answer right from an order of magnitude for a wide range of these things. If it's got n degrees of freedom, the variation between these various ways of doing it tends to be of the order of root n. So 10 to the 27 particles in a kilogram of gas, fluctuation order of 10 to the 13 over that 10 to the 27, so the fractional deviation is going to be of the order of root n. There are very, very general kind of central limit reasons existing, so that tends to be a good estimator.
And Gibbs gives that, which I think is...
Gibbs gives that. But he does it only for the ideal gas.
That's right. But he sort of waves his hand and suggests it's going through for other things. But, I mean, so that's, I think, why he's a bit cavalier about which of these the analogs are correspond to the thermodynamic things. Well, I actually think that he thinks of thermodynamics as a science that applies to stuff in bulk, and if that's what we're interested in recovering, it's not, you know, if the task is to come up with quantities that approximate the thermodynamic quantities as in a large N regime, it's not going to be surprising that there are different quantities you can find at the micro level whose differences wash out, which approximate those thermodynamic quantities for large N.
No, I'm not.
Yeah.
If I gave the impression that this is surprising, then I should correct that.
Okay.
This is, of course, what you would expect anyway, anytime you want to replace some simple description by a much more complicated description and try to recover the original structure in a...
But it's also not going to be worrisome if you think the goal is to recover things that
no,
approximate the thermodynamic behavior in...
That is definitely true. So when I said people are interested in those questions when they are now studying small systems, nano-physics, then they're not interested in merely recovering thermodynamics. They're actually trying to see how far they could extend a thermodynamical description into smaller and smaller systems. You know, it's one thing to say, oh, thermodynamics applies to bulk systems, but there is not a precise definition of what is bulk and what is microscopic. There's a very there's a scale that we can go up and down, and there's not a clear point where we say this side it's thermodynamics and this side it fails. So there is, it's not a worrying problem, but it's an interesting question whether we could have reasons to prefer one set over the other. Gibbs is not quite cavalier about that. He discusses advantages and disadvantages for both sets. Although the answer he comes up with is not quite clear cut. I think, if I remember correctly, he says that this is the most natural choice and this is the simplest choice. So that both of them have something to say for each other. Did you have a question?
Well, yeah, I just think kind of fit on the small system thing. Just as a quick example, these buttons to follow in.
Yes.
You've got about a few hundred degrees of freedom. You do interference experiments, you do very nice experiments, but you do interference experiments with buttons to fullerene. Because these things are warm, they can emit photons of heat during the process. That decoheres them, it destroys the quantum interference. You can model that in some detail, and you get quantum predictions to get confirmed. I think in those cases they use the canonical distribution to describe the molecules. So at least in that case, there's a concrete answer to what they're using. There might be a concrete answer to what must be used.
Yeah.
These are non-hypothetical situations. A lot of them get used in
Discovery
systems.
Is this a good time for a coffee break?
Sure. Well, let me say a few more things. There have been recent papers that point have discussed this issue once more. And they point out that this entropy has the property that it is a so-called adiabatic invariant. That is to say, if we want to perform small, and adiabatic in this case means quasi-static. If we perform very small changes in the external parameter of our Hamiltonian, then this quantity will remain invariant, but the so-called surface entropy, because this is the surface and this is the volume of beneath the energy amplitude, this quantity does not. And since we want to usually have a entropy that is supposed to be invariant under adiabatic quasi-static changes, they think that's an important reason to prefer this one. Although most textbooks always prefer this one. What I find peculiar about this one is that the if I have an entropy surface, an energy hypersurface. So remember, this is the micro-canonical ensemble. So I have some energy hypersurface. And all the states in my ensemble are actually concentrated on that energy hypersurface. So they're moving about in that energy hypersurface. Probability distribution is concentrated purely on energy. For omega, I'm looking at the volume that is contained under the energy hypersurface. And so if this is the surface of a sphere, capital omega would just be the interior of the sphere. And it's going to depend on the value of the Hamiltonian in that region. Now, what I could do, maybe counterfactually, I don't know, but you can consider a change in your model in which the Hamiltonian remains exactly the same on that energy hypersurface, but I change the value of the Hamiltonian somewhere over here. If I do that, then I'm going to affect the volume omega. But it's a change in the value of the Hamiltonian that will only affect regions in phase space, which the systems never reach because all their trajectories lie on energy hypersurface. And so that seems to be weird that changes on the Hamiltonian in regions which the particle, which the system never visits, would appear to affect the entropy that we associate to that particular.
Oh wait, but if I consider two energy hypersurfaces and want to know the entropy difference between those and don't change the Hamiltonian between them, then changing the Hamiltonian down there doesn't change the entropy differences associated with two energy hypersurfaces, does it?
No.
So it's like that. What you seem to be saying is that you can add a constant to you can add a constant to the entropy without changing entropy differences.
I don't think I'm saying that.
Yes, can you compromise? Can you consider like slice of small?
Could you speak up a little bit, please?
Could you compromise? Could you consider a slice of small but finite thickness?
Of course. I mean, if we've got two candidates, then why not come up with a third?
Just one question at a time. I thought Wayne made a good point.
About coffee.
You said no. You said no. I thought, Wayne, you were right. That sounded pretty good.
That's all I wanted to say. There are arguments in favor and in contrast to both of those candidates. If you want to feel that the choice between them matters at all. Okay. Well, so to sum up, there's a variety of choices for picking an ensemble which represents statistical equilibrium. In particular, the canonical and the micro-canonical. And there's a variety of choices you can make for representatives of thermal quantities in each of those ensembles, which would still enable you to recover the fundamental relation of thermodynamics. So it's no big problem to be able to reproduce that. If there's any problem at all, it is that it can be done in so many ways. But yes, has been pointed out several times, and is in fact mentioned by Gibbs himself, if the system we're dealing with is one that consists of many particles, and in particular, if it happens to be an ideal gas consisting of many particles, then as the number of particles is very large, or if you take a limit in which it goes to infinity, then the distinction between the two ensembles will disappear. That is to say, the canonical ensemble will just be will be concentrated very, very closely to a particular energy hypersurface with just some small fluctuations around it. And the values of all of these quantities will also approach to each other. And so there's a general conception in the literature that, in fact, the choice of all these ensembles doesn't matter very much, and this goes under the name of the equivalence of ensembles. And as a rule of thumb, this seems to be working perfectly fine. But one should be cautious sometimes in taking the word equivalent too literally. This has been established for the ideal gas. For systems that are interacting, it is a harder problem, especially if they, for example, would be interacting with forces that do not fall off very quickly, like gravitational forces or Coulomb forces. And although a lot of work has been done in that area too, with good results, at least the results that we expect, namely that the differences will disappear if n goes to infinity under certain conditions. It has also become clear that there are some structural differences between the canonical and the micro-canonical ensemble, which will not disappear as n goes to infinity. And a striking example of that is that, for example, in the canonical ensemble, with the Gibbs definition of entropy, this happens to be a concave functional of the probability distribution. And as a result, the entropy in the canonical ensemble will always be a concave function of other thermodynamical quantities, in particular energy and volume. In fact, you can prove that if you want in just two lines. By contrast, this is not guaranteed to be always be the case in the micro-canonical ensemble. Is that difference important? Yes, it is, because concavity of the entropy is something that we associate with stability of the thermal state under small perturbations. So what, in short, this means is that a canonical distribution is guaranteed to only give you stable thermal states. But we know, of course, that there are thermal systems which are capable of being prepared in a metastable state, like the undercooled gas or the overheated fluid, etc., etc. And it's not like those states of such systems are only weird and rare and decay beyond our control immediately. No, we can, in a laboratory, prepare them at will and maintain them for decent amounts of time. I mean, particle detectors like the Wilson chamber or the cloud chamber, and so all depend on first preparing some fluid in a metastable state. And so it is clear that those systems could never be, or those states could never be described by canonical ensemble. Even though, of course, they do have 10 to the power 23 numbers of particles in. It's not that they are too small. So, although, as a rule of thumb, and for simple systems, it is true that it doesn't really matter very much whether you use a canonical or a micro-canonical ensemble. There are other cases where it can matter a great deal. And the phrase or the belief that all ensembles are equivalent is a slight overstatement, and you shouldn't take that too little. And so there is still some interesting work to be done in this area. The next thing that Gibbs, of course, is going to discuss is the question about the irreversible behavior. I mean, all of this is very successful in the description of equilibrium states in thermodynamics. And we have seen that there are candidates for entropy in that situation. But so far, of course, Gibbs has avoided mentioning anything that was Boltzmann's obsession all through his life, namely to find a representative in the mechanical description of your system of the approach towards equilibrium, or if you like, a representation of that part of the second law of thermodynamics which deals with irreversible changes. And so we could what about non-equilibrium? And in that case, of course, we will have an ensemble which is not stationary and we can ask whether this thing will approach. And in particular, for example, will it do so with an increasing entropy? Now, unfortunately, it's very easy to show that if we take that Gibbs expression for entropy and plug in an arbitrary ensemble, is always going to be constant. This thing will never change its value in the course of time. And so if that is your representative of thermodynamical entropy, you're never going to get a change in entropy in whatever evolution or distribution is going to go through. So although on first sight this looks very similar to Boltzmann's H function, and Boltzmann's H function can change in the course of time, this is not true for the Gibbs entropy. And of course, the reason that is responsible for that distinction is that we have gone up one level up from the distribution function on mu space to the probability density on phase space. And while different points, different particles in mu space could actually collide with each other, in this case, we have a distribution of systems in an ensemble, and the different systems in the ensemble cannot interact with each other. And so there is simply no mechanism for this thing to change. Now, Gibbs is aware of that. In fact, he points it out. But he says we should not draw conclusions too soon. And what he suggests is that, so for example, if he suggests an analogy with the mixing of a dye in, say, a box in a the bottle of paint. So here is once again a picture of phase space. And suppose our initial ensemble happens to be concentrated on a particular region A and takes on the uniform value on that. So rho zero is something like a function. I use symbol 1 to denote a function which is equal to 1 whenever x is a member of A and 0 outside. So this is the characteristic function of that set. Now we divide by the measure of that set in order to obtain normalized distribution. That's a particular initial choice for my probability density, and I can evolve it in time. And now, in typical cases, a little time later, this thing will develop into a region which still has the same area. But changes its shape, and it could typically develop all of these tentacles and range areas spread out until, after some while, that distribution becomes almost a very faint blue U over all of phase space. It would still be a continuous connected set because the dynamics is smooth, so it looked something like this. But the idea is that it resembles the way, for example, if you have a bucket of white paint and you want some blue shade in that, you have a blue dye, you drop it, droplet, and then you start to mix until that dye disperses itself almost uniformly over the entire state space or the bucket of paint. Why is that analogy appropriate? Well, because just as the mixing of those dyes is actually a motion of incompressible fluids, and here too in dynamics, because of Diophil's theorem, the motion of sets in phase space is also such that the measures of all sets are being conserved. And for example, in this case, sigma rho of this kind would simply be, I think it's a logarithm of the size of that set. So it's the set, the measure of that set is conserved, and therefore the entropy is also conserved. Now, what is the point that Gibbs is trying to make? The entropy, the Gibbs entropy, is being preserved in this process. But still, as this ensemble or probability density evolves, it is quite clear that it can approximate, it can converge in some particular sense, very closely, a distribution which is uniform over a larger set, maybe even the entire energy hypersurface. And that distribution which it approximates is one in which is uniform over a much larger region, and therefore its Gibbs entropy will be much larger than that of the set you started with. So, in spite of the fact that the entropy is constant, the Gibbs entropy, or fine-grained entropy as it's called in this context, the distribution itself evolves to one which is almost indistinguishable from a distribution which has a much larger entropy. And Gibbs is suggesting that that might be the way in which we should conceive of the entropy increase thermodynamics and its representation in this framework.
This reminds me of, say, certain approaches to the measurement problem in quantum mechanics. We have an exact solution to the Schrodinger equation. We know that it's a feature of the exact solution that that the pure state never turns into a mixture. Okay, but if we take an inexact solution, then it looks, you know, if we trace over variables that we're not interested in, stuff like that, then it can look as if the wave function, the pure state does turn into a mixture. And people find this encouraging, and I'm always puzzled by this, because I take it in the case where you have the exact solution in your hands, okay, you don't want to appeal to a solution you know to be inexact, okay? It seems like a very, very funny way to reason. And it looks like the same reasoning is what you're describing going on here.
No.
I mean, we know the exact, so we don't need to...
I'm in complete agreement with what you say.
Okay.
If you have an exact solution, that is the solution. And by no amounts of reasoning, I can say, this looks like as if we had something else, and therefore we have something else
right. Instead
of the exact solution.
Right.
That's not the type of conclusion I'm after. It is, however, the case that, at least if this argument works, that the exact solution we have, in spite of its small value of Gibbs entropy, is awfully close to another distribution which has a very high Gibbs entropy. And in fact, we can show that for all measurements we could possibly perform on our system, the two distributions will, up to epsilon, always agree. That is to say, it is very hard in experiment to distinguish between the two situations. Does that mean that I am now entitled to say that we have the other distribution instead of the real distribution? No. Does that mean that from experimental measurements I can actually get a reliable estimate of what the Gibbs entropy is? The answer is no. There are two different ensembles which will agree up to epsilon on every possible measurement you can make on the system, and that might have drastically different Gibbs entropies. In other words, the fact that the Gibbs entropy is actually conserved under the motion is not necessarily, since it is has almost no relation to the measurements we could actually make on the system, it's not necessarily something that we should draw the conclusion that the thermodynamical entropy, but the conclusion is that the relation between the Gibbs entropy and the thermal entropy is not so clear cut.
Good. So what if somebody were to summarize all this by saying, this argument shows that this is a bad statistical mechanical definition of entropy.
I mean, I just want to make the point that Gibbs himself never made the identification of what we call Gibbs entropy for situations outside the canonical distribution, which is supposed to be appropriate for something in context, in equilibrium with a heat bath. Yeah, so. If you wanted to say, I can point out, if you want to say this quantity is a good representative of the thermodynamic entropy outside of the equilibrium, the answer is no, it's not.
Right.
Yeah.
But I do think that Gibbs us the argument that this thing is constant in time.
Yeah, he does, yeah.
Yeah.
And then he introduces the course rating.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Now, one of the points you could ask yourself, this is something that you might expect will occur, and in many cases will occur. But again, it's not guaranteed to happen by the assumptions that Gibbs had made so far. And of course, there's a simple character example, it would be again the harmonic oscillator. If you would take here's the energy height surface, it's the circumference of the ellipse. If I take this to be my set A, then it might evolve, it might extend and shrink along its way. But all the points in this case will remain together, close together in its development. And this might continue for ages and ages, but you will never see the points spreading apart in their evolution. In the way I've drawn over there. And yet it is a perfect mechanical system, and so far this is also a perfect ensemble on it. So we need to make some assumptions about dynamics that would guarantee a property like that. And although Gibbs doesn't tell us exactly what it is, nowadays, we usually call this mixing. So, dynamics is mixing if it happens to be the case that for all A and B, any two regions you choose, measurable regions for definite sake, and I evolve one of those under the time evolution, and I ask what is the intersection of that involved set with any other set B, then the measure of that set as time goes to infinity should actually be just the measure of the two sets taken separately and multiplied. That is to say, if we consider all the points in A, evolve them with the time evolution, then after a very, very long time, the proportion of points of A that end up also being a member of B is just proportional to the size of the original set A and the size of the original set B, which is just the type of uniform mixing that was intended. Now, it is known that this is a property which is stronger than ergodicity, and in as far as ergodicity has been difficult to prove for real life systems, then a fortiori this is also very difficult to prove for real life systems. Of course, one may always say, well, perhaps we don't really need it. Who cares about what happens when time goes to infinity? We, as long as it's close enough for at least pragmatic, reasonable amount of time, we might be happy. But anyway, this is the way the canonical definition that people have come up with to capture Gibbs's intuitive idea. Obviously, as long as the dynamics is time reversal invariant, one can also immediately show that the same thing is also true for the limit for t goes to minus infinity. And so what will happen in the far future will also happen in the distant past, and mixing will occur symmetrically in both directions in time. So again, whenever this gives us the desired conclusion for positive times, it will, just in the way that David taught us this morning, also give us an undesired conclusion for earlier times. So whether this is a successful account of the approach towards equilibrium is also one which is still up to grabs and highly debated. There's another way to look at this is by introducing so-called coarse graining. That is to say, one can introduce some type of partition of the phase space into smaller cells, and then at particular instances of evolution replace the distribution by averages over, you know, all by averages over the points of the values of that distribution amongst the points in one of these cells. In that case, you start out with, suppose that this is all one cell, you start out with a uniform blue distribution, and very soon you will replace this distribution by one which is sort of evenly gray or blue over each of these separate cells, and then very soon you will in fact reach the uniform distribution. That's a very similar idea. Of course, it still relies on the motion being mixing. And it's one typical approach, that is, one of the concrete instantiations of the type of reduction maps that David Wallace was talking about, because the coarse grain description is a reduction map of that kind. It's a projection in the sense that if you coarse grain description, you have already coarse grained, you get the same thing back. And this can give you a change in the Gibbs entropy, if that was still the quantity you were after. Or, if you like, you can go on to discuss the entropy of the coarse grain distribution. Call that the coarse grain Gibbs entropy. And that is allowed to change in time. And it certainly is larger in the uniform distribution than in the initial distribution. But people have sometimes pointed out there is no guarantee that it will change monotonically. It might go down in certain periods.
Hang on, just
about
that. The entropy I would get by iteratively coarse graining and evolving, that is guaranteed to go up. You're saying that
if
the entropy,
yes,
I get to take the underlying dynamics and then figure out, and then have a look at what the coarse grain entropy would be, that could go up.
Yes, yes. Whether that should be a serious problem, I don't know. It would be a serious problem if your aim is to reproduce something like Boltzmann's H theorem. But as I said at that point, Boltzmann's H theorem already produced something both more and less than what was needed in thermodynamics, because there's no guarantee of monotonic entropy in thermodynamics either.
So just the coarse grain of entropy going down in value, is that something incredibly rare and infrequent, or is it, I mean, in the way that one thinks of?
I'd say this depends entirely on what particular distribution you start with and what particular dynamics you are considering. I'm pretty certain you can cook up examples in which it happens.
So it's not like the fluctuations away from equilibrium?
No, it's not something that you can prove of as being extremely rare and something that will disappear if the number of particles goes to infinity. Not that I know.
I just want to clarify something going back to your discussion of mixing. So is what you've got written there otherwise known as strong mixing? And you're just using mixing to refer to that, is that right?
Yes, I'm not so sophisticated that I distinguish between strong and weak mixing.
I'm not sure I heard David correctly, but in the course of setting up a coarse-grained version, so you start doing it and you start getting the dips going the wrong way, can you go back and readjust the way you're coarse-graining and make you, and is it always possible to do it so that you get one that doesn't do that, or is there something really wrong with that?
Can you always, I mean, what do you mean by going back?
Well, you started coarse graining in a certain way.
Yeah.
And you're making changes of a certain amount in a certain, and then you start getting the dips. Can you redo, like go back and do the whole thing again? And is it possible that there's always a way to coarse grain through that will not have the dips? Or is it, you're saying some of them might have dips, but you can, since there's a certain amount of flexibility in how you're doing the coarse graining.
Absolutely.
So is it possible to, because it would make a big difference if it turned out that no matter how you did it, you're going to get the dips in certain cases. If you have a case such that no matter how you do the coarse graining, you're going to get the dips, that seems much more problematic than that some of the ways of coarse grading would have dips.
It would always be a trivial coarse grading that gives you no dips. Just take one big compartment, the entire system. There'll always be a trivial coarse grading that would avoid dips. It gives you a constant entropy.
But something that would still be informative.
Yeah, well, I mean, there is obviously an enormous flexibility in choosing your partitioning. I mean, this would be another way. And there's no guarantee or reason why every set should have the same volume, although, of course, that would be the simplest choice. But the general picture I've been suggesting would be true for all of those partitions. But of course, there are ways of coarse graining which will turn out to be happy, and there might be ways of coarse graining which turn out to be not so fortunate. And if you think you see a dip, the way you suggest, and feel like, oh, this is not what I want, let's go back and redesign my setup so that I coarse grain in a different manner. In fact, this is something that comes up in the discussions of the so-called spin-echo experiment, where the typical or at least naive expectation would be that, you know, you can coarse grain by just looking at the macroscopic observables. In this case, that would be total magnetization. And so you set up the system in one particular way, in which initially there is a large magnetization. And as the system evolves, that dies out until we reach, at least apparently, an equilibrium state in which everything is washed out. And it looks like the system has evolved towards equilibrium, and all the original magnetization has sort of dissipated into the microscopic degrees of freedom. But yet, there is still a particular correlation between all those microparticles which is left. And then, at some point, you can admit a pulse to the system, which will cause all of these magnets to evolve backwards, and the magnetization will suddenly reappear as a spiral. And so, on the coarse level, that would appear, if on this level, that would appear as if there is spontaneously, out of an equilibrium state, the system has evolved back to a non-equilibrium state. Is that a violation of the second law of thermodynamics? No. Does that show that the coarse grain description for that particular coarse graining is sufficient to give you a monotonic increase of entropy and an irreversible approach to the equilibrium state? No. The common, or at least I think it's common, lesson that people draw from this thing is that in this particular case, looking at mere macroscopic observables apparently is not the right coarse grading to do. The question, of course, do we know how or when or why some particular coarse gradings work and others don't? That's yet another question.
Not yet at the end anymore. I mean, I can see someone holding on to the coarse grading and saying, like, what you've done is you've interfered with the system in an external way, which means that the assumptions driving our coarse grading have changed, but it was still fine before you interfered with the pulse.
That's possible, yes.
So, Jos, if I listen attentively enough, you're not applying the condition that the coarse grain cells are macroscopically describable. You're allowing, I can divide them up anyway. Because if that's the case, then what you said is trivially achievable for any initial system, right? There exists some well-tuned coarse graining so that after a time t, one of the cells of the coarse grain will coincide exactly with the future time development. So for any initial system, you can cook up a coarse graining that will give you bad behavior whenever you want.
Yeah, of course, yeah. So if I have an evolution like this, and I happen to choose this set to be member of my coarse graining, and divide all of them up, then it might look like I'm starting out from an almost uniform, or at least spread out distribution, and at some point in evolution, suddenly every point of that set will concentrate in one single cell. And
you can
always coarse grain entropy
might
be
absolutely
minimal.
But, I mean, so this is, I guess, related to the previous question. What makes it, what did you have in mind, what is it that makes it obvious that the spin echo case isn't a violation of the second law?
Maybe we get to that close demons when we hit it with that pulse.
Right. I mean, what's you know, the second law, you know, any surely the second law isn't the claim that on any coarse graining, the entropy isn't going to go down. So you have to pick some coarse grain. Mm-hmm. You know, what is it, given that, why were we so quick to say, no, obviously this isn't a violation. You want a second law with any kind of content, you got to pick some coarse grain. And then you might find find cases where, relative to that coarse graining, the entropy is under certain circumstances reliably going down.
Well, I'll go back and retract that statement. So let me reformulate it in saying that, does this violate second law of thermodynamics? Well, I don't think that's immediately obvious, or that is still a question for which people
can
give different answers. The claim that in order to have some formulation of the second law, you always need some coarse graining.
Right.
That's probably true in the coarse graining approach.
You need some division of the phase space into macro states.
Yes, isn't this
making
the
senior
ones, by writing more scale, the second law, strictly speaking, is concerned with equilibrium transition energy.
Yes.
I mean, this increase of coarse grain entropy is not straightforward in the second law.
One of the things is contentious is that, of course, after the initial stage of the experiment, it appears like all the magnetization has disappeared, and at least prima facie, the state is indistinguishable from an equilibrium state.
Right.
But some people will argue, no, well, that doesn't mean that it's actually in equilibrium state, because the very fact that magnetization reappears at later points actually shows that this is not an equilibrium state.
Don't worry about the point David made. It's not a closed system. You've got to hit it with a pretty big pulse to get it to
absolutely.
The entropy goes down. There's a bigger system there.
No. There's not a bigger system there when the entropy is going down. The minute you hit it, you hit it with the pulse,
so then
it's isolated.
But I want to make a point.
And it's still adiabatically isolated.
Right.
Yeah.
On the other chart, when you had that argument for identifying, integral rho with entropy in the first place, the first step was we're going to identify certain parameters of the Hamiltonian as ones that we can manipulate and use to do work on and we're partitioning any change of energy into the ones due to those plus everything else. And the everything else is TDS, and that's how we got to that. So I think a natural way of looking at it is a division of an energy change into heat and work is always relative to a distinction of the parameters into the ones we can manipulate and the ones that we can't.
Mm-hmm.
And relative to, it turns out that someone who didn't know about, giving the thing a pulse, it would look like a violation of the second law of thermodynamics. but those of us who know about our ability to do that included those in, you know, those parameters among the manipulable ones, and it's not a violation.
David Albert's point that look at just that time period after the pulse is hit,
right,
but before it's gone back to the initial state. Right. It's an isolated system, no one's doing any interventions, and its entropy is going down. And what's that time period? How long is it?
It's that entropy relative to a certain coarse graining is going down, but not necessarily to what, because I mean, the idea of coarse graining is that at a certain point the fine grain details don't matter because we can't, it's useless to us for doing anything work. Those distinctions are useless to us, we can't ascertain them. But the argument for including the finer coarse graining in the spin echo experiment is that, you know, after it looks like it's relaxed to equilibrium, there are still distinctions between macro states that we can make, because direct measurement won't do it, but we can distinguish between states in which all those spins are correlated in the right way and states in which they're not.
By hitting
it with a pulse and seeing if you get that magnetization spike. So the lesson for that is that naively, those look like macroscopically indistinguishable states, but if you're clever enough, they are actually macroscopically distinguishable.
But now I don't understand. If you're clever enough, any two, you know, with electron microscopy, if you're clever enough, any two states are macroscopically distinct.
Seriously?
I don't know.
Seriously?
Let's put it this way. There isn't any obvious upper bound. Or lower bound. Right. I don't know which. You know.
Take the warhorse example of free expansion in a box. You know, you've got a gas that's combined to a one half of box partition. I pull it out, let it wait an hour, and I hand it to you and say, David, you're really, really clever. Tell me which half of the box it was in an hour ago.
I don't know how to do that.
Right. Well, Kelvin would have his whole army of Maxwell demons.
Right.
With cricket bats,
right, and they're very clever.
They would hit each other's molecules backwards,
right,
and then they will say,
right. So I'm, yeah.
So let me try.
Here's the thing. So I mean, what I'm pushing is that entropy is relative to a distinction between
what things are. I'm trying to help you.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
So let me say it.
Yeah.
Right. So you hit it with a pulse,
right,
and it's now manifesting what to us looks like anti-entropic behavior.
Right.
You're saying, but not to someone who has the tools, who could manipulate it in just the right way that this whole thing could be reversed. And we happen to be those people, because if we hit it with another pulse,
right,
it'll go back the other way. So those pulses are exactly the tool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. You know, give me a new tool. Yeah. Give someone a new tool. You can change what they're going to count as the entropy of the system. Yeah.
And so what do they take the entropy to be of that system then? What's the new answer?
Say that again?
So what's the entropy of the spin system? You know, it starts out, you know, with a definite magnetization. Do you need to trigger it, or does it just go off by itself? I don't know.
So if I can restore the initial state, then the entropy of that, you know, final state is the same as the entropy as the initial state was.
But I can understand, then we're going to get a huge collapse, right? So we got, so in these spin ecosystems,
right,
we can have states that are naively of all sorts of different entropies. And a state of very naively low entropy,
mm-hmm,
may pass through many or even all of those,
mm-hmm,
on its way to what looks like equilibrium.
Mm-hmm.
Now that we have this device, the entropies of all those different states are going to turn out to be identified with one another.
Yeah.
Okay. is that kind of entropy going to behave in accord with the usual thermodynamical laws?
Yes, I think so if it's only defined, relative to a certain array of cleverness.
Right.
And I keep that fixed. then don't keep switching.
But is that clear? You mean it's clearly still going to have something to do with, you know, when Boltzmann is deriving the connection between the integral of dq over t
right.
over reversible processes
right.
and the statistical notions of entropy. Yeah, we have a fairly fixed idea from thermodynamics of what we're supposed to be able to do and what we're not supposed to be able to do. What reason is there to think that that identification is going to remain stable over the kinds of redefinitions of entropy that you're talking about? I mean, on your proposal,
right?
In the spin echo case, I mean, I just don't know what the answer to this
okay.
is. On your proposal in the spin echo case, so there's going to be a naive definition of entropy in
right.
the spin echo case,
right?
Which is what you could do without these, you know, without these pulses, okay?
Right.
What you could measure without these pulses, and then a sophisticated definition of entropy
mm-hmm.
with the pulses. And the sophisticated definition of entropy is going to have it that all kinds of very different physical states that the naive definition associated with totally different entropies are going to be declared all to have the same entropy. Right? Right? That is all the states leading from the naively low entropy state up to this particular naively high entropy state are going to be declared to have the same entropy effect.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So the entropy assignments are going to get all mixed up.
I don't see that.
Because there are going to be a bunch of, there are going to be, here's the picture.
Now here's my pitch. Okay, yeah. Think about the entropy of mixing.
Yep.
You know, like there's a gas. What you think is a uniform gas divided by a partition. I take the partition out. You say no increase of entropy. Someone comes along and say, okay, no, actually, those were two different isotopes of the same gas. They have different masses. So actually, there was an increase of entropy there. And the argument is that someone who knew that, instead of just letting them diffuse into each other, could have had them push a piston and do some work. I mean, that doesn't mess things up.
No, but here it seems much more radical. I mean, I'm not sure.
It's the same. I think it's actually not that radical, but it's not the exact same point.
Try to think it this way, Devin. Look, suppose you're in a situation. You and I are playing a game. I say to you, look, I want you to do some work on this. Pull this pulley out a bit. And you say, okay, what resources have I got? And I say, you've got this one system. It's a bunch of disorganized magnets. And you say, you've got to be kidding. And I say, okay, but the thing I haven't told you is that 10 minutes ago it was in
right.
this unified magnetic situation,
right.
and here's a magnetic pulse
right.
generating gadget.
Right.
And at
right.
this point, you can say, okay, now you're talking, now
right.
I can switch. So insofar, I mean, it needs to be an unequal
right.
answer
right.
as to what entropy means outside equilibrium, but insofar as entropy is supposed to be, to play the kind of machine, you know, keeping track of how much work I can do.
No, 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 I agree that it's
going to
keep track of that.
That's a really good point, yo. Hand me something with magnetization, I can use it to do work. Hand me something with a bunch of disordered spins, I can't. But handing me something with a bunch of disordered spins plus something that's going to pulse them and put them all in order, that lets me do the same amount of work.
For sure. And I also don't think that it's going to mess up things too badly. There's a paper by Van Kamper, one of the few papers which I actually agree with, where he discusses the Gibbs paradox and points out that, for example, all these entropy tables for steam that have been composed in the 19th century are going to remain intact, even though we have later discovered that, you know, there are isotopes of water and oxygen of hydrogen and oxygen, and so the steam that they used was actually a mixture, and actually they should have, and from our point of view, we might have therefore argued that they should have adjusted their tables with the entropy of mixing. But of course, for the type of transitions they were studying, that would just be a constant, because the people didn't know about the mixture, but they also didn't have the methods of separating the two isotopes.
And for their purposes, those were the right entropies, because they didn't have the method for separating them, right?
Yeah, and that's interesting. Even if you know that there are these isotopes there, if you can't separate them, it's just a note.
So with the spin echo thing, for if David hands you this disordered nest and also doesn't tell you exactly what kind of pulse you need to fix it, for your purposes, it might as well be just a totally disordered mess.
But yes, this is not really in Gibbs, the idea that entropy could be made dependent on a level of description or dependent on which tools are available to you. But I think it's, I guess you will be talking more about that.
Yeah.
So, shall we postpone that to
tomorrow? Yeah. Are we done?
Yes, I'm happy to be done.
Very good.